if there's no benefit, it dies June this year, never to be resurrected, and I don't see how they can come up with a benefit. Does that help?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm not talking too much.
That's good. That's great information. Thank you. And I believe that what happened last meeting was that there was, you know, it was questions about 37G, and I feel that bridging that trust between the sheriff department and the Latino community and the immigrant community cannot happen without, you know, by supporting 37G. So my next question is, since we are past that, since, you know, you want to support 37G, I think now we can talk about how we can build trust. Mm-hmm. How can we build trust with the Latino community? And I wrote down, I'm going to read off the question.
Okay.
And we all know that unreported crimes are a threat to public safety. And it's not a part of enforcing the law and seeking justice. So how do you plan to build trust with the fast-growing immigrant community?
Okay. First, we're going to have to get out facts, the truth, you know, things like really out there. We have been inundated, and particularly during a political year, with all kinds of scary stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like there's an ISIS member hiding under your bed and, you know, around the corner of the house. In dealing with the Islamic community, let me take that tangent just a ways, because I've dealt quite a bit with Aaliyah Shimmy, and I asked for statistics. What has happened? You know, what are we getting? And so she gave me the statistics. In the last year, they had roughly 30 Islamic members arrested, all for minor issues. One drug, some were burglary, all issues like that. In the public community, they have been very involved in feeding the homeless, feeding the poor, first responder, being everywhere where they're needed. At the same time, they have suffered over 70 hate crimes, being attacked, having their houses vandalized, those type of things, including one Hispanic lady who was beaten up, I think, at Walmart because the person who beat her up thought she was Islamic. So, yeah, we're really making a lot of sense here. You need, to build that trust, you need a top or a high visibility official that steps out and says, folks, this is not true. Here's what we have. There's nothing to fear from this community. Here's what we have. Here's the good things that are being done. Here's what we have over here. One of the things is whenever I came out against 287G, my opponent said, we have deported 15,000 criminal illegal immigrants from Tulsa County. No. Uh-uh. Did not happen. Okay? He's overstating the authority. Okay? Under the 287G, you have two issues figuring in here. One is they have now set aside 190 jail spaces for transport. Now, the 143 that you see held in there, or however many number on ICE holds, those are from surrounding states and surrounding counties. They are not ones that have been arrested here. It's they're brought in here, it's a holding facility. Tulsa County gets paid the money, and they transport them to Dallas. So a big roundup, RPO style roundup, you know, style roundup, people getting arrested, didn't happen. Okay? He just oversold it. And the only other way you can make that 15,000 is over the last 5 years, actually 7 or 8 years since it began, they have been averaging 3,000 times a year that they talk to someone that has been arrested to check about their ancestry. And they hold it and put an ICE hold if they don't have papers in the birthplace of someone other than the United States. That's the only way you make 15,000 is to take those and put them on the ICE hold. Then they come in, they review it, and of those, around 700 a year have been deported. 700 times 5 is not 15,000. Okay? So that's what you need, is someone that comes out and says, people, here's really what we have. Come out. The sheriff does not have this authority he's talking about. Okay? His job is to maintain the jail, patrol, and provide security. Now, often, and here's a part of the problem, because the sheriff's office patrols a lot within the city limits, and that's not really their jurisdiction. That and the police department can complain. You don't, a lot of people don't know the difference when you have action by the police and whether you have a sheriff's office. So those are things that are going to have to get sorted through so that we can provide you with the facts. So is that too much?
No, that was good. Yeah. And what I'm hearing is that there's a lot of misinformation, right?
Absolutely.
Provided and things that are going unreported, information, things that are not being said. So how do you come to increase transparency within the police
function? Wow, is that a good question? I wish you hadn't asked it. Transparency, of course, that is the buzzword.
Right.
That is one of the biggest reasons we've had the problem that we've had. About December, there was a person working with me trying to build a campaign. And we went to the sheriff's office, or he went, filed the papers for the public information documents. We wanted the budgets from the last 5 years. We wanted the annual reports. We wanted all this kind of good stuff that you really do need to say, okay, here's what my program is. 3 months later, I'm contacting Sheriff Robinette, and I said, ask, where is the information? She said, let me check. She said, we have no record of you ever requesting it. Do you know if you which department you requested that of? Transparency is not someone walks in and I tell you, you have to go to that office, and then they tell you to go to that office for the information and back and forth. That's just a maze of confusion. So step one is a single point of question, time and date stamp and a log. You come in, you make the request, they fit it in, you get a receipt for it. Within 30 days, you get your answer, or you ask me. Because ultimately, it's my responsibility to get it there. Also, my philosophy is anything that's paid for with tax dollars, your tax dollars, belongs to you. It should not be hidden under proprietary information or sensitive unit information. It's yours. Did that sort of get there?
And, you know, more recently, you know, we the people, the organization, you know, helped get basically Bates out of, you know, expose all of his laws. And within that, there was a CSI report that came out of that investigation. And my question is, which recommendations, if any, presented by the CSI report do you plan to follow through?
Have you read all 268 of those recommendations?
Just two examples.
Okay, picking out which ones, and there's going to be a real challenge and a half. The first third of it is, I think, is very solid. Just really getting into some issues. To me, when I start getting into the last third of the CSI, where it's talking about this unit should have a different name than this unit and move a person, to me, that's essentially changing the chairs around the dining room table. I didn't see a lot on it, but it has a lot of good information on it. Sharon Robinette is putting in some of them, or Michelle Robinette, I keep calling her Sheriff. Sheriff Michelle Robinette has been trying to put a lot together. I don't have complete faith in the CSI report. There's a lot of areas it did not go into, which is why I requested a full forensic audit, because a new sheriff coming in can't know what to address until he knows what's there. To address which of those 200 and some suggestions, I can't give you that answer. Right,
which
now
one stands out to you most?
On transparency, I also want the budgets tightened up. And one of the things, particularly on the budgets, that really bothers me is the Tulsa County Sheriff's Office is the only sheriff's office in the county here in the state, as far as I know, allowed to keep its own books. All the rest of them are kept by county management, which is what led to all these different accounts floating around and the theft of the prisoners' fees, things of that nature. It allows them to float money around, kind of like one of those pea shell games. Okay, we're moving money over here this day and then over here. That's got to be straightened up. I said I'd drop my hammer, I suppose. But what I do want to do on that, once I get the audit working on that, is John Fitzpatrick, who's one of the Republican candidates, has come up with a really good 6-year plan for modernizing the sheriff's department. So I want to combine those two. And certainly a public information officer, transparency, revamping of the Manning Law organizational chart. That's what we want. Organizational chart, what's our priorities, where are we most effective, what's the most effective, and who's our people,
That sounds like a lot of
there's,
work.
There's a lot, particularly for the next 7 months.
So with that, what can you say in response to some of your critics who say that you may lack the energy and focus to actually implement and make that difference?
What was that question?
there's a lot of work to be done. And
speaking of rocking chairs,
and there's been critics who say that you lack the energy and focus to actually make a difference. So what do you tell to those? What do you say to those critics?
Well, my first impression, and those critics, that critics is a group of about 6 editorial writers on the Tulsa World that said that. And I know where that came from. And I understood that there were 3 or 4 in there that said, we think he lacks the energy, and we lack the energy we saw in my opponent when he crashed the news conference and took it over. That's the kind of energy and leadership Tulsa County needs. If you need a boorish oaf that walks in and makes a fool out of himself in front of the media, go for your energy. I prefer to sit back a little bit and look at what we have. Let's plan this out. What works? Focus? Not quite focus. Let me look at these pictures. I think I have pretty good focus. I have read all of the grand jury recommendations and findings, part of all the testimony transcripts, dug through 287G, ad infinitum to where I thought, well, I'm really confused, and I called the local immigration attorney, and I said, I'm lost, and she says, I've been doing this for 8 years, I'm still lost. So you have a law there that is so confused, even the immigration authorities can't follow it, it's causing us problems. I still see no reason to continue. That's my focus.
And
no.
How will your experience overseas translate back to Tulsa?
Oh wow. Man, I don't know. I got to live. I was so lucky working. Most of the time I lived on the economy and lived with the people, which is so new. And often I got asked, well, weren't you afraid? The only danger to me was my waistline. They kept wanting to feed me more. That's enough. That's enough. I'm going to ask a question here. Who in here, and since most of my time was spent in the Muslim communities, in the Arab communities, do you know what one of the first things an Islamic mother does of a morning? Well, take a guess. No guesses? She fixes breakfast for her family, like everybody else. Their biggest concern is schools, getting their children to schools. It's not like, wow, how can we attack America tomorrow? You know, the cultures are wonderful. People that loop themselves into this little microcosm of we're getting nobody else. In a lot of ways, I feel sorry for them because they've limited themselves to a lot of beauty. A lot of wonderfulness out there. This may seem a little simplistic, but it's kind of like I grew up on a farm with Perry, and if I thought the entire world and the only right meals, my fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and gravy, and stuff like that, I would miss an entire world of wonderful culinary taste and experiences. It's the same way with the people. So we find out what triggers them, how they work. And by and large, we're all pretty much the same thing. We want our children to grow up. We want them to grow up without fear. As far as now to translating on to rebuilding the busted up sheriff's department, when I was in Kosovo, before I left the police department, was the grass.